Hello guys and welcome to the SeedFinder version 1.2 plugin development tutorial, where I will show you how to make your own plugin. So I will start with what you need. You will need Java JDK 8. I'll put a link to the site in the description where you can download the latest version for your OS. Then you will also need the plugin library. For the latest SeedFinder version. If there is no plugin library for the latest SeedFinder version, it's probably still the same. So just use the latest plugin library version that there is. Then you will also need your, of course, the SeedFinder, but also your favorite IDE for Java 8. I'm using Eclipse for this. So if you're using something else, you will have to figure out the first part out yourself. But yeah. So the first part will be about how to set up your project and all the build script and stuff like that, the run configuration. If you already know how to do this, you can skip to the next part already. I'll put some annotations or something in the video so you can do that. And yeah, the next part will be how to set up your basic plugin structure, just to get all the classes and stuff. Then we will take a look at what you have to do to get it working. And yeah, then we take a look at all the features that there are and the optional features like translations. And then I will also do another video on how to build an actual plugin, on how to do something that actually does something useful. So let's get started. All right, I'm in my workspace now. And there I will create a new Java project, which I will call tutorial plugin. In that, we will need our seedfinder.jar. Just paste it in here, in the project folder itself. And then we will go to properties and go to Java build path, add external jars. And yeah, there we select the plugin library, open that and press OK. And then we got it here in referenced libraries. And you can see there's sources connected to it and stuff. So that's all good. And yeah, that's the basic setup to work with it. Now, when we create some classes and stuff, we could go export Java jar file and export stuff and do all that and then run the seed finder. But since we are way too lazy to do that, we create our build.xml file to automatically do that for us. So create a project tag. Let's call that tutorial build script, I would say. And the base directory is our project folder, just represented by the dot, because we're already in there. And the default target will be our build jar, right? So now we have to create a target, otherwise it's going to complain, as you can see here. Default target does not exist. Target name equals, equals build jar. There we go. Close the tag, don't forget that, otherwise it won't work. And we put in there jar, jar file equals, and now slash dot slash project folder. Slash plugin and then slash so plugin will be in our project folder slash plugin subfolder in there, so our seed finder in the project folder will find that plugin, and then we will call it tutorial plugin.jar. All right, our base directory will be the bin folder of our project, where all our class files and stuff will be put in our resources. And it will include all files in all subdirectories. And all, yeah, every file basically. And yeah, that's a build script. Alright. So, now we actually need to use the build script. So we go to the properties again, go to builders, and create a new builder, which will be an ant builder. And let's call that jar builder. Jar builder, there we go. Select our build file and our base directory, which is our project folder. Let's apply that. And then we also want to refresh resources upon completion. Only our project, of course. So yeah, it actually shows up there when the seed finder starts. And then since I'm really lazy, I do the auto build thing. If you have a large project, you shouldn't do that because performance issues. Because every time you save or change anything, it builds the whole thing. Yeah, but that's fine for me right now. Otherwise, you just go to your project and build. Build project or build all or whatever. Yeah, and then you can basically run it, right? So how do we run it now? We can't just click here, right? Since there's, oops, there's no main method. There won't be any main method in our plugin. We can't use this run as thing. So we want the external tools thing. Click on this arrow, external tool configurations, and create a new program run configuration. So let's call that seed finder. And now what program do we run? We run the Java Virtual Machine. Yeah, that's my path to it. That's probably your Java JIE version you have currently. And then I just selected the base folder again, or project folder. And then we also need some arguments, of course, which will be our minus jar and then our jar file seed fi oops. Seed finder version 1.2.2 dot jar. In my case, make sure this is your latest version. And then minus, that's just for me, you don't have to do that. I want to run it in English, otherwise it will start in German for me. Right, now I can run it and get an exception. Hooray, no plugins loaded. Oh. But there is a plugin, it only doesn't contain a plugin.txt apparently. Looks like we need that. So, next part, what do we need? Alright, so let's figure out what we need for our plugin. What's the basic things we need? First of all, let me create a package for my classes, crowd.seedfinder.plugin.tutorial. There we go. Just use your own package name, whatever that is. Then we need three classes and one plugin that txt file as you saw earlier. So let's start with the classes. We need one tutorial seed scanner, which will implement the interface seed scanner. That's our most important class because it does the seed check stuff in this method, which we'll see later on. Then we need a class called, let's call it tutorial candidate. That will be our seed candidate. And I forgot the extends seed candidate. There we go. And it also needs a constructor and unimplemented methods. There we go. That's what it needs. And then we need another class called tutorial panel. And that extends the seed panel. Wait. Oh, plugin panel. Oops. Don't even know my own class names. Good job. Yeah, that's what we need. And of course another file. And since I like to do that, I create a new source folder for all the resources, just to have them separated. And I create another file. You can also put it in your source folder if you want. And we need a file called plugin.txt, in which we will put several things, one of which is the plugin name, which is in my case the tutorial plugin, right? That's our plugin. Then we will have one more important thing, which is where is our main class or our important class, our seed scanner class, which is in my case seed finder plugin dot tutorial dot tutorial seed scanner. That's the class. Then we have some very important information as well. maximum threads and minimum threads. If you care about that, put something other than minus one in there. If you put minus one in there, it just uses the maximum available threads and zero is minimum. Then there are the modes. I will just allow all of them because I don't care. If you care, you want only seed mode 1, then you only put mode 1 in there. If you, for example, want to only allow checking one seed with your plugin, if that is the only thing that makes sense to do. Right. And that's all we need for the basic plugin. We can already run that. But you see now we get a null pointer exception. Why is that? Well, that's because we return null here. You probably already saw the seed finder and the nice GUIs that come with it. You see the changing GUI over there? That's a plugin specific GUI. This is what we are going to create in this part. Right? That's what our panel is for, our plugin panel. You see that GUI generator? This is what generates all these panels. That makes it a lot easier to generate the GUI. If you want to, you can make your own one, but we're not gonna do that here. So, to do this, of course, we want to save it somewhere. Our tutorial panel called panel. Let's just move everything there. And panel equals new tutorial panel. And let's return that. There we go. Now that that is done, we want to give it the generator, right? For that, we will need a constructor in here. Tutorial panel, UI generator, generator. Well, let's just call it gen, so it's easier to write. There we go. And that's already enough to make it run. There we go. Now we don't have a UI. Yay. So, to generate our UI now, let's just say we put a text field on there. Let's save the text field, JText field. Let's call it text. And we just do add text field. This plugin panel with the label and the default value of 10. All right. Then at the end of that thing, we also want to set the layout, so just do a super call, that's that instead. Just do a finish GUI call, otherwise your GUI might look horrible, potentially. And yeah, that's already enough to edit the thing. You can see I can enter stuff there now. Hello world. Cool. That's that, and now let's say we want to access that in our initialization, right? That's why I put a panel here. I can say panel dot, well, I can't access now, so let's say we add a getText method. Oops, return text dot getText, or text field, and then we can say panel dot getText. And with the text. Also want to save that here for initialization. Text equals panel.getText. There we go. Now we can use that in here for our check seed because this text is very important for our seed, right? So, how do we check for seeds? What do we return? We return a list of something that extends seed candidate. We have something that extends seed candidate, right? We have our tutorial candidates. So let's create a list of that. List tutorial candidate. Called candidates. UA array list. There we go. Maybe import the array list as well. Might help. And oops, return candidates. If we just write that right, there we go. And yeah, that's basically an empty list now. Doesn't do anything different. If we had run it would have run it before, it wouldn't have found any either. Because we were just returning null. Which you can also do. If you just return null, it's like you found nothing. So if we do some check-in, yeah, we already defined, nope, that seed is not good, just return null. Right. So, now we wanna create our tutorial candidate, right? Candidate equals new tutorial candidate. And this already requires a seed for the default seed candidate. Here we go. And of course, we want to add that to the list. Add candidate. Okay. So now we want to add our very important text. So we need to change our constructor here. String text. And we want to save that. So this.text equals text. We need a variable for that. Private string text equals text. Oops. Just text like that. Yeah, that's that. And now when we want to output that, right? We want to use a logger. We have a seed finder logger, so we want to save that. Seed finder logger. There we go. Call logger. And we get that in the initialization from the context dot get logger. We go. And when we found a candidate, we say logger dot log. Oops. Just put method and class name in there. Not gonna do that now. And yeah, then we can say epic seed found and add some parameters here after that. So now these the list that you can put lots of parameters there. So let's make the first one a line separator, just for fun. That's the percent zero. It's the line separator now, and percent one will be the next one, which will be let's say our candidate, right? So what will it output? It will output what we write here. So we write here in the string builder. String builder, and at the end we return that dot to string to make it more efficient because all this is very inefficient. Append. Now we say seed. Hold on. Oops. And append the seed, get seed. Here we go. And don't forget the system.line separator. And append. Oops. Very important text. Right? Because it's very important. Append text. And another line separator. There we go. That's our candidate. This will also be written in the candidates file, as you will see very soon. So it's logging that now. So if we run it now and say, let's just put something in there, hello world, right? And run it for, let's say, 10 seats so we don't get spammed. There we go. It's done with that. And now if I press F5, you see, there's a candidates file. Cool, we got seats in there. Yeah, because I didn't refresh it, didn't finish the write. But yeah, you can see now it's totally fine with doing that, and it finds all our epic seats. Cool. So that's the basic stuff. What you can do, and let's get into translation. So for translating stuff, we want to use resource files. Which is something you probably want to do anyway, so let's just do that tutorial plugin, let's call it like that, dot properties, that's how you call it. That's not how you write properties. Properties, like that. Okay, so now we can put some keys in there, let's call one label, which will be called epic label, right? Because it's very epic. And then we let's say first of all, we should write down static final string our resource file name, which is tutorial underscore plugin. Just this front part there before the dot. And then to load that, we go into the seed scanner and override that one method we haven't overwritten, which is initialize resource bundle. And if your IDE does that as well, remove the default because it doesn't make sense to have it there. And there you get a class loader. How do you use that class loader? Well, you call resources dot add bundle. Now you need the bundle name, which we saved in the tutorial panel dot resource file name, and the class loader. That's all we need to do. Now it's loaded. Right, it's loaded, but how do we access it now? We need to write down our bundle ID, which we get from this method. You see, it returns a unique bundle ID used to access the bundle. Bundle ID equals resource bundle.addBundle. There we go. Now, we give that to our UI bundle ID. Add that to the constructor over here. Oops. There we go. And now we can use it. So we want to load our label, right? We called it label, so we might want to add a constant for that. Public static file string. Let's just call it label as well. There we go. Now we can access it like that from the constant. So now we say, instead of just put a string in there, resources.getResource, and we use this one. This one is for the main program. So if you happen to use the same resources, you can do that, but I would suggest just use this one all the time. So let's use the key, which is label, and our bundle ID. There we go. And that's loading the resources. So we start this now. See epic label, which is the thing we put in there. Cool, right? So now we can even add translations with this. So if we say new file tutorial underscore plugin dot properties, right? That's properties, that's a standard name. If we now, before the dot, add an underscore, let's say DE for German, you can have that file and copy the contents over and just translate it, or just put something completely different there. German label, it's not German, but whatever. And now, if we now run it, well, you see, it's the epic label, but now if we change the language, hey, it's a German label. It's a German label. Yay. Right. So that's the translation. Now, another feature that there is you can quickly show that to you, which I mentioned in the video about the 1.2 version. You have your own help sections for the plugins, how to use the plugins. So the only plugin doesn't provide a help text at the moment. So we need two things in the properties file. First one is the plugin name. You can look up these keys if you go to reference libraries and go to internationalization resources. There's a lot of keys. So there is the plugin name key, plugin name, and there's a help text key. These keys is what we need. Plugin name and help text. So let's start with the plugin name. Plugin name is tutorial plugin. So if we start it now. Also, you don't have to add things to both resource files. You have to have everything in your base file. But if everything that isn't in here will be looked up in here. So if I translate this, let me just go in here. You see, now we have the name here, and it says this plugin does not provide any help text, right? So if I translate it now, see, it's a German label now. If I go to help, says tutorial plugin and says the German version of the text here. So that's working. Then we can add a help text. So let's add a really, really helpful Oops, I can write helpful help text, right? Because it's really helpful. And then we go to help, help, and that's really helpful help text. Hooray. So yeah, there you can explain how your plugin works and yeah, what the settings do and all that stuff. So that's clear. I've done that for my plugins as well, so yeah. It might help. So if you have questions about what this setting does, look in the help section. The plugin might explain it. So that's that, and that's all the basic features there is. And in the next video, I will explain you how to do a proper plugin, how to use the biome code, which you can do with this, and yeah, then get onto how to optimize your plugin and make all the right checks in the right order to make it run faster and all that stuff. So yeah, see you next time. Goodbye, everyone.